you're right next door to Millersville University, and there's a lot of talk about flipped classroom, taking the instruction, embedding that in the home so that you can do extension in the classroom during the school day with your teachers and use the expertise to do that kind of questioning. So Monty pulled together myself and Helena, who's here, her predecessor, Jane Bray, who was the previous dean of the School of Education, and we had a conversation about how we can do this, how we can partner together so that we're making best use of young college students from Millersville to help enhance what we're doing in the classroom. And any good leader is only as great as his staff. And you heard Monty talk about Charlie, who's our director of technology, very innovative. And another person who works for me is Vickie Hallock. And Vickie is our supervisor of elementary education. She's been in the district many years. She has a background as a kindergarten teacher, but also a secondary art teacher. And when I became superintendent, the board said, who do you need to help move Penn Manor forward? And I said, Vicky's the person, because she understands elementary education, she understands early childhood, but more importantly, she is a master at bringing people together, to bringing teachers together to solve problems and to create solutions that move us forward. So Vickie has done a wonderful job working with Dr. Ollie Drayon from Millersville University, and at this point I'd like to have Vickie come forward and talk to you a little bit about our experience with the open classroom and taking that concept and making it real and responsive to what we're actually teaching in our classroom and not something that we're purchasing off the shelf. So Vickie.
I'd like to thank everybody for the opportunity to be here tonight. I would like to share with you the project that we started about 2 years ago. But first I want to ask you some questions. How many of you look back on your memories of homework, either in elementary school, middle school, high school, even college, with memories that were fond memories? How many of you had those experiences? Don't see too many hands up there. And I also want to ask you, how many of you remember struggling with those who supported you at home in the area of homework? Okay. Well, what we often hear from parents today is that homework sessions at home are anything but pleasant. Parents often battle with comments like, that's not the way my teacher taught me today. You don't know how to do it. Okay, or struggle with the concepts that look very different from the way they were, what they were exposed to during their years in educational, or during their educational careers. Oops, my apologies. Let's take a look at this homework sheet from 1974. Oh my, I'm sorry. Now let's take a look at this homework sheet from 2014. Not much has changed in many ways. Now I'm really generalizing. We have many innovative teachers who have done a lot with trying to bring homework into a more meaningful platform. But we do have lots of situations where homework is lacking. We want homework to be something that children experience time to have some practice, to have some meaningful time to be learning new concepts, mastering new concepts. So what we wanted to do is see what we could do to change the concept of this homework, make the process more meaningful, more engaging, more productive, and we were determined to find some answers. I'm here tonight to talk about the journey with the Flipped Classroom Project and partnership that we formed with Millersville University. We all know, and we've heard tonight, the power of relationships. And that in anything that we do, whether that's educating children, working with colleagues, trying to get anything off the ground, we realize the power of relationships is key. So what is the flipped model? It's a model where the typical lecture or presentation of material and homework are reversed. Short video clips are viewed by students at home, while in the class, time is devoted to discussion and application of the content facilitated by the teacher. Let me emphasize the word application. And we all know with the push for and the need for transforming what we do in the classroom to meet the new challenges with Common Core, PA Common Core, we need to have these things in place. We also need to emphasize with the development in our students' 21st century skills that are so necessary for students to be successful in the workplace. Some of these, just to name a few, critical thinking, problem solving, collaboration, and effective oral and written communication. Again, just to name a few. We started this project, as Dr. Mike shared, with Monty Milner from the Hourglass Foundation, Dr. Jane Bray, professor at Millersville University, and we sat down, we talked about this concept. We talked about forming this partnership, and I'm happy to report that we're approaching our second year with this project. I was determined to involve teachers in Penn Manor who were innovative thinkers, enthusiastic about the teaching profession, flexible, collaborative, and frankly, people who were a pleasure to be with. The older I get, the more I realize it's important to surround myself with people who I enjoy being with. So people often ask me, how did you choose these teachers? Again, they needed to have the qualifications, but again, they needed to be people who were flexible, people who were going to be collaborative, and people who, frankly, again, were a pleasure to be with. The initial team consisted of our IT director, Mr. Charlie Reisinger, three sixth grade teachers, two fourth grade teachers, in three different schools. We expanded during the 2013-14 school year to include an additional sixth grade class and two fifth grade classes. We partnered with Dr. Oliver Dreon, instructional technology professor at Millersville, along with Dr. Jennifer Shettle, who is an MU literacy professor. These two people have worked closely with the Millersville students, and we've partnered successfully. The journey began. Our initial meetings were centered on developing the concept, narrowing down our curricular area of focus, and the timeline for the implementation. We knew if we were going to be successful with this, we needed to start small, we needed to make sure that we covered all of the details. We concentrated on the area of language arts, specifically reading instruction. When we started this process, we used the ADDIE model of design. And I just want to go through a few of these steps, share a few of these different steps that we took in each of these phases. In the analysis phase, Penn Manor joined the Millersville University staff to review the project details, review the types of data that would be used to evaluate the project. These included end-of-lesson vocabulary, skills tests, etc. We also discussed details concerning substitute coverage, and scheduling collaborative sessions that needed to occur between Millersville and Penn Manor staff. Again, these needed to be worked out ahead of time. We needed to make sure we could budget for these items, and we needed to make sure that we were going to fit into a timely situation for both Millersville students in semester situations and our students. Phase two, with the guidance from our Penn Manor teachers, students in the Millersville courses began to develop short preview clips. These were called proof of concept clips that were intended to help the students at Millersville develop into these longer clips that they ended up with. Students were actually collaborative in their efforts. They worked in small groups. We concentrated on nonfiction reading that our students would be exposed to in their reading lessons. Phase three, the development. These draft proposals, again, were shared with the Penn Manor teachers on site, as well as a group of students, and students can be brutally honest, and that was the goal. Gathered groups of students around the table. We just had a session last week with this course that we're in now, or this particular semester we're in now, and students gave the Millersville students some feedback. Fourth grade, sixth grade students, again, very, very honest feedback. Were these clips engaging? Were some of these things going to be things that would actually help them learn material? And we were surprised at some of the outcomes last semester. Some of these videos were beautifully created, but the most effective and the most the videos that were most appealing to our students were the types that were interactive, the types that got them engaged, and the types of video clips where they actually developed some relationships with these Millersville students through the clips, because many of the students were actually their own actors in these particular clips. So that continued. We also worked with the implementation phase. These final videos, typically 5 to 10 minutes, not very long in length, focused on a particular skill or vocabulary development, and they were actually implemented with our students. What happened in this situation, we were actually able to share these clips with our Penn Manor teachers to make sure that they were adequate, that they covered the material that the teachers expected them to cover. More discussion occurred, more meeting time occurred, and again, the implementation took place. In the evaluation phase, student data was collected after the lessons to analyze. Were we successful? Did this help students actually achieve mastery in some of these areas? We found great success. Many of you might be wondering, how did the technology integration occur, and how many students did we need to worry about with having access to technology? We are extremely fortunate to have an IT director in our district, Mr. Charlie Reisinger, who continues to be a part of curriculum discussion on a regular basis. Again, we are extremely fortunate. He was involved in this project from the beginning, and he will provide you with some information regarding the technology elements of the project. Thanks, Charlie.
Good evening, gang. So I'd just like to start by saying that to produce a project such as this, you don't necessarily need to have an amazing multimedia technology server team. You don't have to have the latest and greatest gadgets or the most amazing infrastructure. One of our key design principles for this project was to come up with a high-tech concept, but with a very low-tech delivery. Because if you stop and think about it for a second, we really didn't know going into this that every single one of our students would have access to a high-speed internet connection. There's still sections of Lancaster County that are not reached by Comcast, or for many families, the cost of a high-speed connection is simply out of bounds for them. So when we initially designed how we were going to deliver these videos, we thought, well, how can we do this in a low-tech fashion and make sure that we reach every single child? So instead of going for high gloss, okay, expensive delivery systems, expensive video systems, we turned to something that was very simplistic, something that we assumed that every single child, every single family might just have in their homes, the humble DVD player, right? Which we thought, again, not very expensive, usually something we would typically find. So that was one low-cost way of delivering the final technology project out to our parents and out to our families. We also distributed the video content on simple flash drives, $5 flash drive. Many families had older computers at home. They didn't necessarily have internet connections. So this was another delivery system for the program. And then in some cases, we had families that didn't have anything at home. So what we did is we simply loaded the videos on laptops. Nowadays, you don't need to spend $1,000 to have a very highly capable, great laptop that will play video content. In this case, we went with a file format that was relatively universal, MP4. But again, we made those laptops available for any family that was interested in or needed to have that level of access. I will make one other point, and I think Vicky's going to talk about this in a second, but the keynote was so phenomenal because there were these themes of collaboration and story and play. Extremely powerful, engaging ideas for young kids. And as the Millersville students were working with our teachers, with our students, and they were developing these video skits that eventually went out on these devices, it was amazing to see how those themes of story and play and characters were coming out. We saw those Sesame Street characters early on that were sort of mimicking like a board-like meeting, right? And some of those skits actually played out in the videos, and it was just remarkable to see that level of development from the MU students with feedback and the feedback loops that were happening with our kids.
Just a few more comments. This is just a shot of one of our sessions that involved the Millersville students and our students in the classroom, in one of our classrooms in Penn Manor. These clips, the power of these clips, when they were developed and used, students could view these as often as they needed to view them. Some students said they viewed them 5 to 10 times. Another student said, I viewed it once and I knew the material, or I was successful with the material. The power came when teachers were back in the classroom the next day, because teachers could serve as facilitators of some rich discussion. They didn't need to spend as much time going over the actual initial lesson elements. They could actually go deeper. They could actually get into much more meaningful discussion with students during the day. So this is not to replace the teacher. This is to make the teacher time with students much more meaningful and much more productive. Our future. Okay, we found success with this model. Future direction, we hope to expand to the primary grades. That's our goal for next year. We are in the process this year, grades 4, 5, and 6. We, again, would like to expand to the K-1, 2, and 3 world. And I have some teachers who are interested already just from hearing about this. We're going to be doing some staff development with our teachers this summer because we'd like to get this concept expanded across the board. And we do have many teachers who are actually using this flipped concept in their classrooms already and doing it very successfully. We started small with this project, knowing that careful planning, thoughtful development of a timeline, and implementation phases that were well thought out were critical. We hope to continue the partnership with Millersville, and in addition, we have some ideas to actually incorporate our high school students into a project like this. So many of them are doing the graduation projects. They're involved with all kinds of elements in their coursework. So again, I see this expanding to hopefully involve our high school world. And I haven't talked to our superintendent about that yet, so we'll be having some more conversations soon. Additional outcomes include teachers who are involved in this project, again, researching and wanting to implement more of the flipped model. Administrators and school leaders can help teachers get started, become interested in the model, by making sure just a few key things happen. Help teachers to rethink what actually happens during class and how time away from the classroom can be better utilized. Modeling the behavior for teachers by using the flipped method as we create meaningful staff development sessions. You know, we often say students look to adults to model for them. You know, teachers look to administrators to model for them as well. So I see this flipped concept going beyond the classroom and actually having a place in staff development. And then making the production aspect of creating videos as easy as possible, as Charlie had alluded to, and making access or giving students access as easily as we possibly can. We recognize that many of our parents don't have computers or don't have internet access. We pay attention to those details on a daily basis. So again, leveling the playing field, making sure that all students have access to what we're producing is critical. I would like Charlie just to share one more thing about that high school piece. Because of this new initiative, some new things might be possible.
So I think the best way to describe this is potentially flipping the flip model. So I think we'd all agree that knowledge is born from experience. And one of the best ways for our students to learn is to actually create the learning artifacts. Right? If you think back to anything that anything that you ever learned and you learned really well, you learned it by doing, right? By actually getting involved in developing a product and polishing rough edges and just learning through doing. So what we foresee down the road to expand this, you know, where this project was the initial catalyst, we see our high school one-to-one giving a laptop to every child as being an accelerant to this type of learning, where students can actually get involved, high school students can get involved in producing these artifacts, you know, getting involved in the feedback loop, working with our elementary kids, working with our teachers, and putting those high school students in the driver's seat to develop learning objects, learning artifacts. I think that really closes the loop and creates the most powerful learning experiences, not only for our elementary students that are benefiting from this work, but also from our high school students that are getting the best taste of a real-world learning exercise. So we really see that as our future. Again, putting the students in the driver's seat and having them own the learning.
One last thing I'd like to mention, which I forgot to do previously, is Dr. Oliver Drayon, in the course that he teaches, this instructional technology instructional class, he actually has taken this whole initiative. And his students, at the end of the semester, their final exam is to present the data to our our Penn Manor staff. We go over to Millersville, and they actually, for about a 2 to 3 hour period, go through all of the flipped videos that they created. We review them, and we review the data that comes back from the student assessments. So it's a great way, it's an authentic way to understand, for them to understand what they're going to be expected to do when they get out into the teaching world. And it gives us an opportunity to continue to build that partnership. So again, we hope to continue the process, the project. If anybody has any concerns, questions, anything you'd like me to share in terms of our journey to help you get started if you're interested, my contact information is up here. Again, I want to thank the foundation for allowing me to speak to you tonight. Thanks again.